Hello, I'm Skid from the Widescreen Gaming Forum. Today I'm going to be giving you a look at Star Conflict. Now, this game actually came out about a year ago. In fact, this game was actually started development 2 years ago. Now, the reason I know this is because after I tried to get Strike Vector to work, got it partially working but really couldn't deal with the controls, I decided that I remember I've got a game that's something like this. And I remember that around about a few months ago, they actually fixed their multi-monitor support, because it released with pretty much no multi-monitor support at all. I don't think you could even select the resolution. I think I managed to get it working, but it basically just blew up and just pixelated to all hell. And then they later fixed that to allow you to select the resolution, but it was vertical minus, and now they've since fixed it. So yeah, a combination of things is now making me look at this now, a year after it came out. But to be fair in the game, you can't actually see it on this screen, I don't think, but this game is actually still in open beta. It's in, there you go, 0.16 or 0.916. So they're getting close to their release target. So now's as good a time to look at it as any other. Now, this is a free-to-play space combat game. They list it as, well, it's listed in Steam as action free-to-play massive multiplayer. Now, originally, when this game came out, it could not be classed as massive multiplayer, but they have since made a few tweaks. And this is, I think, where the massive multiplayer comes into, Sector Conquest. I'm not entirely familiar about exactly what's going on here, but I suspect this is just a general conquest sort of thing, whereby the corporations are battling for these territories, and this is how they're classing it as massive multiplayer. The game itself, however, primarily is more of an arena game. But we shall quickly go through the options menu first, because that's where we normally do. So, as I said, they fixed the multi-monitor support, so the resolution now comes up natively. So it's in there, it's all happy and good. There's some decent graphic options. I've disabled anti-aliasing, partly because I was getting some stuttering in-game while I was recording. I can actually use x4 anti-aliasing in-game without recording fine, and I'll get 60 frames per second. I could probably bump it up higher than that, but yeah, I've disabled it for the purpose of this recording. Incidentally, I would like people's opinions on this. I'm elected to keep the, effectively, my frames per second counter, which lists on the left, the frames per second the game is running at and what I'm recording at. This isn't necessarily a good guide because, as I said, I'm recording, so that will naturally drop the video frames per second, but it might give you an idea of how the game is running, whether or not the video is smooth and whatnot else. But if you want me to get rid of it, I will do. But since it's up in the left-hand corner, it's way out of the way. But yeah, graphic options are alright. You can limit the game specifically to a particular frames per second if you want to. I've got VSync enabled, so it limits it to 60 by default anyway. Standard audio options, you can enable a load of things and change all the volumes independently, which is always nice. Some game options. Some of these are a little strange and not well explained. For example, ship control method basically just lists basic and expert. I'll get the words out eventually. From what I've read up, the difference between the two is that basic uses the full size of the screen to determine how quick you turn, and it also turns your camera with it. Now, this has a freelancer type of control system whereby you have a cursor and you move the cursor around and your ship follows the cursor, but your turrets try to point at the cursor so long as they're within the dead zone. So that's why you might want to change between the two. Expert, from what I've read, basically binds the movement to a square rather than the full screen, which is useful for a multi-monitor system because it means you don't have to move your mouse all the way over to the left-hand side to get a full turn. So that's one thing to note. Afterburner reactivation, I presume, just automatically reactivates the afterburner if you run out of energy for it, and just some general options to change how the game plays. You've got a decent amount of HUD options. That's a ship position marker, yeah. Yeah, I didn't actually fully check this, I should have done. You can't move some of the elements in from the side of the screen, so for example you have the map up one, or the chase camera up one side and the map up the other. I can't see a way to move them, but it does look like, yeah, you can at least move these icons, so you can bind them to the reticles so that you can easily see where enemies are coming from, which is extremely useful. But yeah, you can't move the edges. Unfortunately, there's no real critical information other than the radar and your team's health if you're playing a PvE game. Notifications are just things that will pop up, so they're just standard stuff that you would typically find in an MMO. They're stuff that appear in chat window or on screen, then you can also customize the chat to a certain degree. So, as I said, this is a free-to-play game, so I will quickly have a look through the free-to-play options. I'm a little on the fence as to whether or not I think it's fair. But basically, you have two types of currency. You have, I forget what they call it, standard credits, I think they are. What are they called? Oh, they're just called credits. So yeah, they're standard credits. You have standard credits, which are the currency that you earn just for playing. And then you also have galactic standards. And these are the premium currency. So if we have a look here, we've got about 3,300 for about £9. Now, oops. As with most games of this type, there is a paid subscription in the way of licenses. So you can see that the 1 month license is about 3,000 credits, so that's pretty much £9, which is somewhere about on par with what you'd normally pay for a normal subscription-based model. The boost for this gives you a bit effectively 50% extra credits, loyalty, and synergy. Now, synergy is also very important. If I go back to this ship here, the synergy is effectively how in sync you are with your ship. And as your ship's synergy increases, so does its stats, or basically your control of the ship increases, so you can get more out of it. Now, one of the reasons why the paid model is a little bit suspicious is because you see all these ships down here, these were premium ships. Now, you can only unlock them once you've got a certain rank with a particular faction, but the problem is that these ships basically have full synergy and you basically pay for them. So they're an accelerant, but they're an incredibly fast accelerant. And one of the problems with it is that if you pick this ship, then it has full synergy and it will give you spare synergy that you can then transfer into free synergy, which is this here, which can be used on any ship. Now the problem with that is that that costs more money. So you have to be very careful if you're going to go with a premium ship, because if you go with a premium ship and you use it a lot, then you're going to get synergy points, but you have to then convert them into free synergy to use them on these ships to progress down the tree, which basically means that you then have to pay more money, and that's where the problem comes in. The system is relatively fair otherwise, because effectively ships within the same tier, so for example this guard frigate compared to this guard frigate, the stats between the two of them, this is paid and this is one that I've leveled up myself, are very much the same or have very slight differences. So you're not strictly speaking paying for power, you're just paying for a massive jump ahead of everyone else. Other things that you can buy with the credits are upgrades to weapons. Now, do I actually have enough money? I don't. But I think I have items in here that I can explain from. So there you go. Basically, the ship or everything is broken down into tiers and then marks. Tiers, if I go back to ships, sorry, I know this is a little all over the place. It took me a while to get a hang of it myself, but yeah. Tiers are basically, you see these numbers here? These are the tier of the ship. And as the tiers go up, the ships basically get stronger. Now, these are what tiers are. So all of these, rank 1, 2, and 3, are tier 1 ships. And then all of these are tier 2 ships, and all of these are tier 3 ships. So the increase in tiers make them more powerful, and when you increase in tiers, the items that you can equip with them also increase in tier. So if we go to here, this is actually a tier 1 railgun. Is that actually the one? Yeah, because that's been upgraded one. So it's tier 1, and if I go to upgrade, this is actually already a Mark II railgun because it's blue. There is a way of seeing that, but I don't know if I can see it on here. Is it shown on here? There it is. So yeah, you can see that this one here, which hasn't been upgraded yet, is a Mark 1. Now, you upgrade it to Mark 2 using your standard credits, which you get from playing the game. You can also upgrade them using, this is effectively a special upgrade kit that you can get as a reward for winning a match. Now, when you get to Tier 2, to upgrade it to Tier 3, you have one of two options. You can either pay credits, or you can pay loyalty points. Now, loyalty points are earned by completing contracts. So if we again go up here, click contracts, there's basically, there's three factions in the game, and there's two sub-factions for each faction, if that makes sense. And you sign these contracts, up to three of them, and if you complete them, you get loyalty points, and then you can use those loyalty points to upgrade technologies that that particular faction makes. So, again, if we go back to the warehouse, as you can see, the assault railgun, if I go upgrade, requires raid loyalty vouchers. Now, if I wanted to upgrade, say, the beam cannon again, I actually need warden loyalty vouchers, or loyalty vouchers, which I don't have any of because I'm going down the Jericho path for ships. You can go down multiple paths if you really want to, but you're going to slow your progression down very, very large amounts if you do that. So yeah, that about covers... Oh no, there's one more thing. Can you tell that I really don't plan these out in advance? I'd be more professional if I had more time, but I do this as a hobby. But anyway, yeah. The other thing you can do is customize your ships. Now, there's basically only really two options for customization. You can equip a flag, like a very nice Union Jack, to your ships. Now, you have to do this per ship. So every time you want to upgrade a ship or add customization to a ship, you have to pay again. As far as I can tell, you cannot remove them from one ship and put it on another. So if you're going to do this sort of customization, it's probably best if you wait until you get to at least tier 3 or tier 4, where you're going to be using a particular ship for a decent amount of time. But yeah, these can only be bought with Galactic Standards. Everything else in the game you can acquire normally through just playing the game and earning standard credits. So yeah, this kind of customization has to be bought with Galactic Standards. You can actually customize specific colors, but the actual colors themselves are fairly limited. I suppose that is one other thing that I keep forgetting. You can actually purchase them for 7 days, which makes them a lot cheaper. So if you really, really must customize your ship's color, that looks hideous. I much prefer that as a custom one. I think that looks nice. Is that really the best one? Yeah, the white one isn't bad. But yeah, you can purchase them for effectively a 7 day. So on the earlier ships, you probably want to purchase 7 day ones just because you're not going to be using them for a massive amount of time. Now, in terms of the speed of progress normally, I will get to the game soon, don't worry. In terms of speed of progress normally, over the weekend, I pretty much unlocked all of these by hand. So I've got max synergy on 4 different ships, and I've got synergy level 2, 3, and 7 on these. I also then purchased all of these ships using them Galactic Standards. So I did that over the course of the weekend, and I did it in about the equivalent of, how long would it be? 4 hours maybe, I think. Now, as I mentioned earlier, this weekend actually marked the second anniversary of the game starting development, and the devs actually put a event on this weekend whereby you got double synergy, double credits, and ships and everything cost half the price. So basically you're looking at something like a 300% saving on everything. So getting to this particular point would have probably taken me 8 hours. I think that might be slightly unfair because I did spend a lot of time just sitting in the lobby chatting to people to learn things, so I'd say probably between 6 hours would probably be a fairer statement. So yeah, it would have probably taken about 6 hours to get to this point. Now basically everything speeds up once you get to or money income speeds up once you start using tier 2 ships because you get more rewards, but it definitely feels as if you are heavily encouraged, or at least relatively penalized, if you don't sort of like buy a license. because this gives you a flat 50% boost on everything. So you will just progress 50% quicker. It's that simple. So yeah, I mean, I think that that kind of behavior, although it's a little bit like cheeky, it is a free-to-play game. They have to make money. So if you're just going to play it for free, you should expect for it to like take you longer. I think that's perfectly reasonable. The other thing, oh yeah, you've also got these up here, which I keep forgetting about because they're not really worth it. You can give yourself small additional boosts. The ones you can buy with money gives you actual game booster speed, weapons, or not these, sorry, not money. The ones you can buy with in-game credits gives you speed boost, and weapon damage. So they're reasonable because they're all paid with in-game currency. These ones here basically give you extra attempts to loot at the end of a match. So these give you the potential to get in nicer stuff at the end of the match. So, right, I think that covers the vast majority of it. You also have implants here, which are basically as you level up, you can gain access to these, and you can pick any one that you want. And they're basically just boosts to help you customize yourself or your character or your ships. From what I've been told, these are, although you can like equip up to the highest level of your ship, if you're using a rank 4 ship, the rank 5 boost won't apply. But yeah. Okay, so I think I've covered everything for the most part. I need to do that at some point. So yeah, so let's get into the meat of the game. I'm going to start with a PvE match, partly because, let's see which one. We'll go with that one because it's interesting enough. So yeah, I'll start with a PvE match because it will give me a chance to explain without like being too challenging. But yeah, it'll help me explain a little better. So while we're waiting for that, this sometimes takes a blindingly short amount of time. I can't actually show the ship list. Now, you can see here in my hangar, I've got 3 different ships. The ships are all classified into different types. Basically, there's 3 sizes of ships: interceptors, fighters, and frigates, in that order. And as you would expect, interceptors are fast, nippy little ships, but don't have a massive amount of firepower. They're designed to get in and get out, so like covert op ships, recon ships are all classified as interceptors. Fighter ships are effectively what will make up the core of your army. They have a decent amount of speed and a reasonable amount of firepower. And we are getting into game. And I have 2 fighters. I have a command frigate, which is this first one here, which is the one I will start with, assuming no one else is using one. Nope. This one here is a tackler, and this one here is a guard ship. Now, the command ship basically is supposed to be the front of the army, or the front of the attacking force. I can give boosts to my fellow, or to my teammates around me within a particular radius. But I don't have quite as much power as something like a gunship, which is again another fighter. There we go, we're at 60 frames per second. So let's boost all my teammates. So yeah, this ship focuses on effectively being the front of the army. You're expected to fight in a group and try and stay alive, which is what the special ability, which is in the middle of my hotbar that's marked as F, will let me do. Now, each particular ship class has a special ability. This particular ship is a something, I don't know, I can't click on it to find out. It's a special kind of shield. It basically, my aim's off. It basically protects my ship from all incoming damage, but it does so at the cost of my energy bar here. So this can make me extremely survivable for a short period of time. I think it lasts about 15 seconds. So yeah, the flight mechanics of the game itself, as I said, is a lot like Freelancer. I do have the ability to strafe. You won't notice it as much, but you can probably just see it. You can strafe in all directions. But yeah, your ship tracks your cursor, and your cursor is pointing to where your weapons will fly. And you want to lead your targets to make sure that your weapons hit them. Now, you can do this even without the cursor there if you have a reasonable eye and a rough idea of how fast things are moving and that sort of thing. So you don't actually need to have the target indicator on, so long as you can roughly work out how fast they're going and where they're going to be, so you can lead the target yourself. But yeah, it's basically a combat game. We done? No, I think we've got a boss incoming, don't we? Yeah, no, we're targets on. Oh, I forgot to show you something, never mind. I can show you when I do the PvP match after this. But yeah, all the different ships have different roles, so this one, as I said, is the front of the army. The Tackler, which is the other fighter ship, or fighter class ship that I have. Buggers. The Tackler, which is the other fighter ship I have, is designed to intercept and debuff. Primarily it's designed as a counter to faster interceptors, because it can lock them in place and slow them down, but it also has the ability to, I think it's called Target Painter, which will increase the amount of damage a particular ship takes. So the Tackler is very much designed to intercept a ship and then hold it in place while a gunship deals the vast majority of the damage to it. The last ship I have is a guard ship. Now the guard ship is, as it sounds, it's designed to guard. Now, should I equip the Tackler? No, because this is an assault. I'll equip the guard ship on the last mission and I will show you that one, because it's got a neat little special ability. Attention mercenaries, our new goal is to eliminate the indicated targets. And away we go. I will tank a bunch of damage with it, because I can. Now, missiles in this game are actually fairly limited. If you've paid attention, you'll notice I start with 6. If I use up all 6, I can actually get more, but they will be on a very long cooldown to regenerate. So, generally speaking, the way you want to be using your weapons is that you will use your... You will use your guns to weaken an enemy, and then if the enemy looks like it's going to start evading and getting away, you'll want to be firing off a missile to finish him off. I'm taking a lot of turret fire. You, sir, can die. Your weapons also do overheat if you're not careful. Letting your weapons overheat is actually a bad idea, because it takes longer for them to cool down if they overheat. So the best course of action is to stop firing before they overheat and quickly drain the quickly allow them to cool. Let's get rid of some of these turrets, because they are being a royal nuisance, and because I have a limited I can tank these almost unlimited. Oh, no, there goes my shield. So much information that I've gotten to giving you. I've just remembered that I should have mentioned that there's actually a difference between the three different factions. Well, there's a few differences, but I'll list the main one first. Whoa, there's a lot of ships about. We've lost the ship. Falling out of the battlefield? That is highly unfair. There's a lot of enemies about. Okay, let the energy should recharge. Shield back up. And I've lost my energy shield. There's a lot of targets there. Where are my teammates? And now I'm taking hull damage. Come on, energy shield, hold! Whoa! I'm screwed, there's just too many of them. So while I'm waiting to see whether or not my teammate that can't fly can survive, he's a sniper. He's running a long-range ship. I'm not sure which faction he's using. I think...
enemy ship destroyed.
Yeah, there's basically two types of long-range ship. One of them is from the faction I'm in, the Jericho faction. It's basically a long-range torpedo boat. It fires a guided torpedo warhead that... excuse me, well, it doesn't do a massive... excuse me again. While it doesn't do a massive amount of damage, he might be in trouble. Yeah, while it doesn't do a massive amount of damage, it does have a decent area effect, and you can effectively hide behind rocks, so it makes you... yeah, he's screwed. Makes you very survivable. Yeah, it makes you very survivable if you can, did you just take out the last one? Or is there one more? Nope, there's one more left. The Jericho long-range ship allows you to hide behind things and still fire. The other one, which I think is an Empire, has a disintegrator cannon, and it is literally a sniper. The disintegrator cannon is basically an extreme range weapon. So it can fire from the other side of the map, but of course it needs line of sight, so hostiles will easily see... you need to dodge more! Will easily see where you are and then can hunt you down and kill you. I think he's flying a recon ship. I'm not particularly sure the specific ship he's flying. No, he's covert ops. He's flying a covert ops ship because he can cloak. Yeah, in terms of the UI, I actually have the map up, but by default you have that, which I always refer to as a Gravidar radar because that's what I've always been known it as. I think it was Free Space that first gave me that name, the Gravidar radar, but I can't be sure. Yeah, I call it a Gravity Radar. The problem is it's so far out of the way, it's not particularly useful to be able to see at a glance. But fortunately, if you press M, you turn it into a map, which tells you where everything is horizontally, which in my opinion is far more useful. So I always have it on that. On the left-hand side, you have your target tracker. So once you lock onto a target, it will give you an image of effectively that particular object that you're fighting. Do I have mouse control? Well, at least I wasn't the first to die. Does he not know I'm trying to record a video? Anyway, the differences between the three different faction ships. The primary one is that Federation ships, I think it's Federation ships, are basically, they have the faster ships. They have average hull and average shield strengths, but their weapons or their ships fly faster. They just move faster. I don't think they're more maneuverable. I just think they're flat out faster, if I remember correctly. Empire ships have much higher hull strengths at the sacrifice of shield strengths, and Jericho have much higher shield strengths at the have much higher shield strength at the sacrifice of hull strength. Now, I'm predominantly going with Jericho, so Jericho probably have the best guard ships because of how the guard ships' special abilities work. I will explain it now so I don't end up needing to explain it later when we get in mission, or assuming he survives and can destroy this. The guard ship, the special abilities in a guard ship allows you to effectively, what would be best described as cycling the phase of your shield. There's three types of weapon damage: thermal, kinetic, and EMP, or electromagnetic. Now, the special ability of the guard ship is that you can cycle your phase of the shield to heavily tank one particular element. And I mean heavily, I think it bumps it by 150, which is an enormous amount. So a guard ship is designed to be slow, immobile objects to guard objects or guard positions, as might be apparent by its name. And it primarily does that by its ability just to survive and tank in the hands of a good pilot that knows what kind of damage is coming at it. First class flight. Now, can I bring up that? I can. What ship was the other guy's flying? He was flying an engineering ship. And he was the first to die, which probably means he went straight in for the attack rather than... No, that generates 5, so yeah, that's not a premium ship. An easy way to know whether or not it's a premium ship is that premium ships generate... There we go. Premium ships generate 20% free synergy. generate 20% free synergy, whereas standard ships don't. So this will be the boss battle, which is basically just going to turn into a try and survive and tank, which is why I've switched weapons. He typically uses thermal weapons, and that typically means I should just be able to flat out tank it. So what I'm going to do is sit here and torpedo him. And that torpedo has missed. We do have an engineering ship here, don't we? We do. I'm getting a shield boost, that's good. I'd be concerned if I wasn't getting a shield boost. Whoa! What the hell? That That went through my shields and just destroyed me. Ah, crap, yeah. It took me out with Pulsar, which is one of the abilities that my card ship actually has. I should have fucking seen that coming. What class of ship is he in? I think he's in a gunship. No, he's in an engineering ship. Oh, we had two engineers. They could have and should have healed me. But yeah, no, that was entirely my fault, my death. We shouldn't have the firepower to win this. I mean, the thing's pretty much still at full health. This is going to take him too long. He doesn't have the firepower to beat him. In fact, is there two of them? Ah no, that's just the directional icon. It's showing despite the fact he's actually still on screen. So yeah, this is the loot system. If I had won, I would have got three loots, and given that it would have been my first win of the day, I would have got a rare loot as well, but yeah, that didn't go well. I still got 80,000 credits for it, so that's still a lot. But I think I would have got something like 16,000 if I had actually won. So we'll go into a PvP match, yeah, next, just because it won't take as long. So is there anything specific I need to go through? I've been through the very basics of the different ships. Not all of them though, but I've also covered the differences between the different three factions. Some ship types aren't available with some of the factions. So for example, the Jerichos, they don't have gunships or recon ships. So that's something to bear in mind. It's probably worth looking up a guide, because these ships have different roles and some people are going to prefer different roles to others, so if you look it up, then you might be able to work out roughly what you want to play as. Try and find a fighting style to match yours. So we'll go into a PvP battle. Now, this could go either way, because I'm going into a public battle, and as they are, sometimes they don't work together, sometimes they do work together. It's a bit hit and miss, so you could end up in a really one-sided battle. or you could end up in a really close battle. I had one the other day whereby we started really strong, but pretty much everybody was fighting in the center. We captured two beacons. I was holding one beacon on my own because they were coming one by one at me, and I was in a tackle ship, so I could just cloak the second they were about to kill me and then finish them off by after sweeping around the back of them. But yeah, after that fight, we like got it down to about halfway, and we very much was winning, but then the other team got their act together and then our team just fell apart. But yeah, it goes one way or another if you're in a public match. So it's probably worth looking for a corporation, because this is basically the clan system, the guild system in the game, and then finding or partying up and then coordinating together. That's where you're going to find the most fun out of this game. Hopefully, if we win this, I will be able to upgrade some equipment, but we shall see. As you can see here, there's about 1,500 people playing at the moment. 850 are currently on mission, and 144 are waiting to take off. And there we go. That noise means that we are ready. What type of battle is this? Domination. So I will stick with my command frigate unless there are many people in command frigates. Two people in command frigates, three people in command frigates. That's probably reasonable. We've also got some tacklers, and it looks like we've got a couple of guards as well. So we actually have a balanced party. So we'll see how this goes. Now, there are multiple different game modes. This one, Domination. I've only got three in range, that means most of them have gone left. That's going to hit the Lloyd. Can I finish him? Yeah, I'm on my own, I don't want to be here. Disable those to give me a bit of extra speed, and then sneak around and try and catch up. If he's following me, he's doing a really stupid thing. He's getting really lucky. And I just wasted a load of time trying to take care of him.
Our beacon has been captured.
The enemy by far has the advantage at the moment. I've lost the cursor. And I'm alone. I'm good as dead. They are better equipped than me. I'm basically using flat out tier 1 gear all around, and I was taken out with people with tier 4 gear. Sorry, not tier 4. Mark 4. can't take me in a one-on-one fight. You can if there's more than one of them. Bollocks! He dealt more damage than I expected him to. This is not going well. Yeah, the enemy is just annihilating us. So if you have a look at the map, this is the fundamental problem. Because we're not working together, we are all over the place, which makes us easy to pick off. I shouldn't fly into that. They've got a couple of torpedo boats. Three different people attacking me again. Yeah, we've lost this. Yeah, I'm spawning in to lose. Yeah, that's how one-sided they can be, these matches can be. That did not go well. I got enough money to repair my ship, but yeah, we did bad, real bad. I don't think that's enough money for me to upgrade anything. Killed three pilots, got a little bit of extra money. So let's sign that one, and that one, because they're the most valuable. And let's give this another go. Do I have enough to upgrade this? Nope. Nowhere near. And I'm not going to top up my money with the real money or real credits, so never mind that. Did I get no synergy for... yeah, I guess not. So, let's try this again. Hopefully it'll put me on the winning side. Unfortunately, public matches are pretty much always like this. Every game I've played, it's always hit and miss. It depends entirely upon the team you get thrown in. Sometimes they work well together, other times they crush you, other times you crush them. Completely hit and miss. But hopefully, I'm at least giving you a decent idea of what the game's like. I can clearly see what and where did I... huh? I like it. I can clearly see what and where... did I get it? Efficiency visualization update. Efficiency visualization? I have no idea what that's supposed to be. I'll have to pay a little bit more attention, so I won't vote on that. See if I can't find out what that is. I'm assuming it's efficiency in a match. Dum-da-dum. Waiting in a queue. To be fair, my average wait in this has always been lower than my average wait in a game like Dota 2, and that has way more players. I can sell that because I'm not using it. It's not going to give me enough money to upgrade anything, but I can sell it. They're useful. Oh yeah! These things here. These are actually premium ordnance. You have to buy ordnance for your weapons. You have to buy missiles, period. Otherwise you can't fire them. But if you buy ordnance for your weapons, they will do slightly more damage. But you can also buy premium ammo. Now, it's not as bad as it sounds. Premium ammo does one thing. It doubles the amount of synergy you get for kills and assists. That's it. It has no other benefit than that. So buying premium ammo is again a good way of accelerating your progress by gaining synergy for your current ship. So let us see if this fight will go any better. Probably not. Can I actually buy a license now? I still have 300 spare synergy or credits, so I could buy a one-day license, but nah. I won't at the moment. I'm not particularly good at using these or this particular ship in PvP. I mean, it tanks to hell, but in PvP you get a lot of different damage sources. And also, using a ship like this requires that you have at least some sort of defense nearby, because it doesn't have a lot of firepower. I could use this, my tackler. It served me well in the PvP matches I've done so far, but in all honesty, I prefer my command ships. I like the boosts they give you and the fact that you can make yourself temporarily immortal. How immortal you make yourself is dependent on how many people are trying to kill you. Is there anything else that I can talk about? Oh, there we go, we're in match. Damn it, another domination. I was hoping it would give me us a different game type. So, he's in command ship, he's in a recon. Tackler. Command. Three commands, 10 players. Oh, he's changed off command. No, he's changed to command. No, he's changed back. Too many command ships.
Attention all ships, prepare for battle. We have entered the sector.
Good, I am still getting boost from the command ships. I was worried for a second that the command ships wasn't actually boosting me. So yeah, the tackler, the two abilities I have in this are target painter, which increases the amount of damage everyone will do on a target. The other ability I have allows me to slow the target down by a pretty significant margin. He is actually in range. Why didn't that track it? Fire at me now! Ah! They got a guard ship. That pulsar should not last that long, I'm sure of it. Slow the fuck down so we can take you out. That is what this ship is designed to do. Guys, I am not going into this fight alone. Damn that guard ship! Still doing poorly.
Our beacon has been captured.
Yeah, they've got three beacons now. We've pretty much lost this. He cloaked, so I better get out of here, otherwise he's just going to decloak on me. Still gonna lose this, but I can try and be helpful. What the hell? I thought I had more health than that, but never mind. Okay, so that didn't go well at all in any of the three games. I went abysmally. I have no idea what this efficiency visualization is supposed to be. Yep, that went badly, never mind. Can't be helped. So yeah, that's basically... I forget the name of the game now. Star Conflict. That's basically Star Conflict. As I said, public matches is always going to be hit and miss. You're better off finding a corporation and then partying up, because then at least you'll have decent compositions and then people will actually work together rather than just try and fly off on their own. Now, I know I'm not particularly good for trying or keeping together, but I try at least. I try to follow where the pack is going, but of course if the pack is going everywhere, there's no one to follow. But never mind. Anyway. It's a reasonable amount of fun. It's certainly worth checking out. It's a free-to-play game, so you've got no excuse not to check it out. They did fix their multi-monitor support. It didn't have it initially. If that isn't a reason to check it out, I don't know what is. But yeah. So, that's Star Conflict. I'm having fun with it at the moment. I will probably sink a bit of money into it. But yeah, that just leads me to say thank you very much for watching, and I will see you next time.